Hi, welcome to the Brick Filmers Guild podcast, hosted by us, the Four Monkeys. On this podcast, we had the extreme pleasure of chatting with David Pagano and David Pickett. These two brick filmers just recently co-authored a brick filming book called the Lego Animation Book, Make Your Own Lego Movies. They also run the Lego animation blog called The Set Bump. David Pagano is a Lego animator, writer, and the founder of Paganimation, a New York-based production studio. His work has appeared everywhere from Brick Journal to the Wall Street Journal. He also won BFG's Brick Filmer of the Year in 2012. David Pickett is the Lego filmmaker behind Brick 101 and Nightly News at 9. He is a judge for this year's 2016 BFG Film Festival and also judged the 2014 and 2015 editions of the festival as well. This podcast is sponsored by the Lego animation book Make Your Own Lego Movies. This book is an illustrative and comprehensive guide to stop-motion animation that covers everything from equipment suggestions and lighting techniques to creating special effects and covering emotion. The Lego animation book Make Your Own Lego Movies is a must-get for any brick filmer from novice to expert, perfect for all ages. So, without further ado, here's our conversation with David Pickett and David Pagano about this incredible book that they co-wrote. This morning we have David Pagano of Paganimation and David Pickett of Brick 101, formerly Nightly News at 9, joining us this morning. Good morning, guys, and thank you so much for joining us.
Good morning.
Hi, everyone.
Thanks for having us.
Well, we appreciate you joining us. I know it's a little bit early, but nothing that a little coffee and tea won't fix, right?
Absolutely. Do we need to specify which of us is which of us? Because
as far as
listeners know, we're both two voices in a cold room somewhere.
Your voices sound a little different. I'm hoping it doesn't sound 100% the same on the recording, but that was Pagano, right?
Oh, yeah, that's what
okay,
I meant. I just
cool.
meant, do you need us to introduce ourselves by name?
Maybe the first time or whatnot so people know, but beyond that...
Okay.
Yeah, that sounds good.
And we'll also direct our questions to the last names.
Oh, that makes sense.
And...
So if anybody hasn't heard, these two guys just had a book published that's called The Lego Animation Book, Make Your Own Lego Movies. And it's a really great book for brick filmers, either the experts or the novice just getting into it. So got to say kudos. It's a very, very good book.
Thank you. We're glad you enjoyed it.
So it starts off, has a, in the introduction, it shows a couple of sig figs for you guys, and has a bio for you, and it's what's really interesting about you guys is that much of your information is nearly identical. You,
both born in 1985, both have the middle name of Michael, you both wear glasses. Have you guys ever been in the same room? Does it cause any kind of space-time continuum thing?
Yeah, we actually met at we actually met at the Lego fan convention Brickworld Chicago back in, what was that, 2008, maybe?
I don't even know anymore. Everything after we started writing this book is a blur.
Right. As you said, we tend to cause space-time continuum paradoxes when we're in the same place together. But he was giving a presentation on Lego animation, and I came up and introduced myself, like, hey, you might know me as this brick filmer who did this thing. And he came back the following year, and we just really hit it off and hung out together and started making jokes and talking about Lego animation. So.
Well, and I remember when I first met Dave Pickett, I was like, oh, you're the guy who made The Frankie Job. That's kind of like a weird, interesting film. And then I sort of went away for a while. And then I came back later and saw things for Nightly News at 9, like the green promotional ad or the Svelte commercial. And I was like, okay, parody commercials, got it. I will be friends with this person.
Yeah, we both kind of fill that niche of Lego brick films that are like weird commercial parodies from the 90s. So
absolutely.
Cool. So not only have you created this book, but there's also a companion film for the book called The Magic Picnic. Is that correct?
It is in progress.
It is correct in the technical sense. I think only the tense of the grammar is what will. Although I don't know when will this interview be released.
Probably in a couple weeks. Within a week or two.
In a week or two. Mm-hmm. By the time this interview comes out, it should be out. I would imagine.
So it's very close to coming out.
Yes, we are about to release a film called The Magic Picnic that was produced in tandem with this book, and the idea behind the film is that we talk about all sorts of techniques and approaches in the book, and we tried to set up the film in a way where like each shot kind of shows off one of those techniques or one of those approaches. Some of them are just there because we think they look cool or we wanted to do something funny, but we tried to give people a motion sense of the things that we demonstrate in the book in a static way, because animation is a motion picture medium, and some of that stuff is just not as clear in a book as it is on the screen.
Oh, that's awesome. We'll look forward to seeing that for sure.
And where will we find out about it, or we just need to just keep looking at the link that's provided in the book's introduction?
We'll be blasting that out on all of our channels, so if you don't hear about it, that will be our fault. But
still blasting!
It'll be on the Brick 101 YouTube channel, it'll be on the No Starch website, it'll be on Picanimation, it'll be on all of our social media. As soon as it's done, we're going to be promoting the heck out of it. Right now, we're still finishing it, so that's why we've been a little quieter on that front, just because we've got our heads down working.
And yep. It will be on our website, too, of course. So we will also blast it for you.
Cool. Thank you. We appreciate it.
So now, I know Pagano started making Lego animations in 1995. Pickett began in 1998. Obviously, you are both well-known, super accomplished brick filmers. Where do you guys, each of you, typically brick film? Pagano, if you want to take this first.
Where do you
brick film? Well, you probably do it all over, depending on where you are, what shows are going on.
That's true. So I most of my film work is done out of a studio in Brooklyn that I've been in for a couple years now, and I actually share it with the artist Sean Kenny, who's a Lego certified professional. Share a building. His sculpture stuff is in the front. My animation stuff's in the back. That's where most of that action happens. So it's been nice to be in and amongst other Lego artists because he has a whole team that he works with. And I sort of do my own thing in the back. And I also photograph his sculptures quite often, which I will, in fact, be doing right after we hang up today.
Wow, I'm big time wow on that
one. And do you get to borrow him or any of his folks to help on builds?
Once in a while. I mean, it's more just like walking down the hall and being like, hey, how would you build this? And this is either one of us asking, or does this piece exist in this color? Did they ever make that? It's all kinds of super technical / nerdy questions like that. And also just a lot of discussions, and this is related to discussions that Dave Pickett and I have a lot about the idea of Lego as a medium for art and artistic expression, and whether that's through sculptures or portraiture or filmmaking. That's a discussion I like having and something I think a lot about.
Okay. And what about your studio, Pickett?
Yeah, so I'm actually really excited. Just like 2 weeks ago, I signed a lease and moved into a studio for the first time. I had been operating out of my apartment. Just my husband was kind enough to give me one of the rooms of our apartment to turn into my Lego studio. But yeah, as of a couple weeks ago, I got to the point where I was ready to move out. So I now have a separate studio offsite. It's in the neighborhood Wicker Park, which is kind of like the Brooklyn of Chicago, in another way that David and I are similar.
We are the same person.
And it's in a really cool building that has a lot of different studios for different artists. I think I'm the only Lego artist in the building that I've seen so far, but there's painters and sculptors, and there's a theater group, and like an escape room, and a walking tour, all sorts of really cool stuff in this building. So yeah, I'm still like moving in. So I haven't really done a video on the new space yet, but I'll probably be doing something about it on Brick 101's YouTube channel soon.
Wow, what an exciting, creative place to work. A lot of good vibes there.
And a lot of your films aren't actually, I guess, brick films. There are a lot of Lego build tutorials and stuff like that. Is that correct?
That's right. So I started out my YouTube channel solely as a animated web series called The Nightly News at 9. But over time, I've gotten lots of feedback from my audience. They wanted to see other videos from me. So that started as how to build tutorials. I've moved into product reviews, dipping my toe into a little bit of video gaming and vlogging as well. So yeah, Brick 101 is now kind of like a full service digital media video fun entertainment company, you know, still centered around Lego as the core. But branching out in different ways as I grow and experiment.
Wonderful. All right, now, focusing on your amazing book, chapter one.
Wait, what?
We wrote a book? When did that happen?
Chapter one discusses what you'll need to make a Lego animation. What did you use when you first started, both of you? If you remember way back when, Pickett, what did you used to use?
Camera-wise and whatnot equipment.
Yeah,
get the feeling we're going to have the same answer on this.
yeah, when I started filmmaking, you know, my family had one of those big old school video cameras you actually needed to like put a VHS tape into.
Yeah.
So, you know, back then it was a lot more limited than what, you know, 8-year-olds have access to today. So I just, you know, would play around with that. And obviously the first thing I wanted to film was, you know, Lego. And so when I did stop motion animation with that camera, I'd literally press the record button. It would record a second of video, and then I'd like press record again to stop it. And so it was like the double press of the button for every kind of frame you wanted to capture. But then the frames would be inconsistent lengths because you were just like kind of double pressing a button. So yeah, my earliest animations, which I still have to hunt down in my parents' basement somewhere, were pretty choppy. So, you know, it's amazing what kids have access to today in terms of, you know, smartphone apps, as we talk about in the book. You know, they have like a whole suite of tools they can get for free, you know, provided you have a smartphone. And it's just really incredible what starting filmmakers have at their disposal.
Agreed. And Pagano, I guess you're exactly the same as that.
Yeah, I had the exact same situation. Giant shoulder mount VHS camcorder with one frame per second animation action. That camera got me through a lot. There was actually a very hilarious period where I was using a Windows 98 machine with a capture card. And the source for the capture card was the composite out of a giant VHS camcorder. So I had the oldest, not the oldest, but a relatively old video technology being piped into what was then kind of the current, maybe not state of the art, but up to date video capture technology. And I remember using things like the celebrated software program MGI Video Wave 2 to edit things, and I can't even remember what was Dave, do you remember the name of that that free software that used to be this is like pre Monkey Jam, pre Helium Frog? I want to say it was called like Anasazi or something like that.
That does sound familiar, but you have to remember I was animating blind for years, so...
Oh, that's true.
And I was editing in Windows Movie Maker, so whatever program you were using sounds even fancier than my setup.
My condolences.
Cool. All right, we're going to kind of move on here to Chapter 2, which was probably one of my favorite chapters in the book, which it discusses animating the minifigure. There's about a dozen pages there, which is pretty much worth the... the price of the book alone just for those pages on basically how to animate your minifigure. Do you guys have any insight into that chapter and kind of how you got some of the movements together?
Sure.
I can take this one if you want, Dave.
Go ahead. You start.
So despite the fact that Dave and I are often classified as doppelgangers of each other, we do have fairly different approaches to the way that we make films. Dave sort of alluded to that a little bit with the way that he shot blind for many years, which I also did, but now cannot imagine going back to. But so for the minifigure animation chapter, Dave sort of took the reins on the minifigure gestures, because especially with something like the Nightly News at 9, a lot of that is characters kind of standing at the side of a news story or sitting at a desk and moving their limbs in tandem with the dialogue. Whereas I did the opposite of standing at a news story, which is the sort of walking and running cycles and talking about that sort of movement, which is not something that Dave does often. So in this chapter, we both sort of let our individual specialties kind of complement each other and built out the chapter that way.
Yeah, and I want to say also, like, as I was doing the research for this chapter, I was watching a lot of brick films and trying to break down, especially brick films that don't have dialogue, because you have to do so much more storytelling with the animation when there's no words. So, you know, I was watching a lot of David's films and, like, kind of analyzing the different ways the characters would, like, move their arms to say, like, I've got an idea. One of my favorite things that I kind of discovered in that process is what I dubbed the arm nod, which [S2] Yes. [S1] Is, like, since minifigures can't nod their heads up and down, how do you indicate, like, a minifigure giving a nonverbal yes? And something I noticed again and again in David Pagano's work is, you know, kind of how characters, when they have that moment in the film where they have the realization or they're saying yes, they'll kind of lift their arm up and down, kind of like a nod. And it translates really well. Like, watching it, you understand what the character is trying to say, even though a human would, like, never do that with their arm. So, you know, it was really interesting to kind of look at what are the unique gestures to minifigures, how do they communicate nonverbally, and then how can we kind of break that down and explain it to readers. So that was, like, just a really fun part. And yeah, getting to what David was saying, I hate doing walk cycles. I avoid them at all costs.
It's only worse when you have to have, like, five of them doing it at the same time.
Yeah, I would just rewrite that script and give them all wheels or,
you know. One of my coworkers actually constantly gives me grief when I have to adapt scripts, and I'm like, oh, I'll just have these five characters or 12 characters walk at once, and she'll just, like, glare at me and be like, as the person in charge of the schedule on this project, no, you will not.
Yeah, it is kind of nice when you have a little creative freedom on your just your own personal brick film, knowing to cater to your own lack of voicing for us or whatever. We'll just adjust the script so we don't have to say a certain thing or do something. It's kind of funny.
Oh, yeah.
So in chapter 3, which is animation principles, loads of amazing tips that translate to animating anything, not just brick films. So, I mean, really helpful information that you can apply to clay and other non-Lego
theory and whatnot.
Materials.
So I will preface this by saying this is the chapter that almost broke me.
It's true.
Because I have never felt less like I knew how to animate than when I tried to write this chapter. This is the chapter that took the longest to write out of all the chapters in the book, I would say. And honestly, kind of to tie into what Dave Pickett was just talking about, you know, the idea of going through films and picking out things like the arm nod and giving them names. You know, a lot of the stuff that I do at work, I don't always know. I'm not always aware of what I'm doing when I animate. I just sort of instinctually do it. And some of that comes from my education. Like, I went to college and studied animation, and some of that just comes from the hilarious length of time that I've been doing this for. But as my company has grown and as my crew has grown, I've started to need to get those things that I do instinctively out of my brain and to be able to explain them to people in a way that makes sense and they can follow. So that idea was critical for this chapter, because I had to really not only go through my own brain and be like, oh, okay, what do I know that I do and how does it relate to the animation principles? But also, I discovered that I had been thinking about a bunch of them wrong for 10 years, or just the way that I thought I understood them, I didn't. So writing chapter 3 was really a learning experience for me as well, to be able to explain all that stuff that I just sort of do without thinking about at this point, but being able to explain it to people who are potentially doing it for the first time. And it was important to me that that stuff came across clearly, because I feel like it's some of the stuff that people don't necessarily think about first when they get into brick filming.
Yeah, absolutely. And I just want to piggyback on what he was saying and point out another one of the few differences between us is that, you know, he went to school for animation, whereas I did not study any animation ever. Like, I didn't even know the principles of animation until I was reading this chapter to edit it for him. Like, I hadn't even read, you know, the Disney book on animation, which I don't even know the name of. The Illusion of Life. The Illusion of Life. And so, you know, just reading this, for me, like, it was great to be in the editing role because I was able to just, like, come at it fresh. But also, it's some of the stuff in here, it's like, oh, yeah, that would really help in an animation. Or I backed into that accidentally. If only I had known that when I was getting started. One of the jokes I've been making about the book is that I really wish I had a time machine so I could go back and give it to myself as an 8-year-old, because, you know, I didn't know any of this when I was starting. And it's, you know, things like easing, timing and spacing, like all these like really core principles that make up, you know, how you trick people into thinking a collection of still frames is actually something alive. It's really amazing how David was able to get that clear and make me understand the difference between timing and spacing. And if he can teach me, he can teach anybody.
I was teaching myself at the same time, believe me.
Well, you can bring that book back to my 38-year-old self, too. Because I sure could have used it.
No, I mean, it's so helpful. I mean, as you guys probably know, and through the years, so many, especially young kids, always want to know, you know, how do you do this, how do you do that, and to be able to have this kind of guide that will literally, you know, show them easily how to do this is just an amazing gift, really.
Thanks.
Thank you.
I'd also like to give a shout out to not only all of the teachers that I had in school who impressed a lot of these things upon me, but also to all of my friends and colleagues who were kind enough to read through this chapter repeatedly for me and be like, no, this doesn't make sense. You're wrong about this. This is actually backwards. Slip them around, and you should put in a part about arcs.
Oh.
Nice.
Well, that's definitely a chapter I'll need to be going through a few more times. So,
sweet.
Moving on to chapter 4, the building for brick films. Basically, I guess it kind of goes over a lot of the brick features that work for making your brick films. Could you go into any detail about some of the items in this chapter? Like securing sets or utilizing clutch power, hinges?
Yeah, you know, one of the things we talk about in this chapter is the dreaded set bump. you know, that is this phenomenon where you've put together this really elaborate set that you're going to film on, and then in the middle of animation, whether due to your own clumsiness, the dreaded force of gravity, or something else, you know, the set moves and then it looks like an earthquake happened in your animation. So it's something that afflicts every brick filmer. That's why we named our blog after it. We really want to just kind of go through, like, here's all the steps you can take to, like, really avoid set bumps, because it's so devastating when that happens. This, I think, is also one of the chapters that really gets into, like, why are you doing this with Lego? Like, here's the specific concerns to doing stop-motion animation with Lego. A lot of the other chapters, you know, can apply to filmmaking or stop-motion animation broadly, but this one's really about, like, okay, you're using Lego. Here's all the things you need to know. Here's different types of pieces that are going to help you, that could be hurtful to you. I think one of my favorite things in this book is the character Loose Man that David created to illustrate when you don't have a character who's going to be easy to control.
I actually can't take credit for that. That was one of my coworkers, Matt Witham, designed Loose Man.
He's cute.
Oh, I think it'd be neat to try to do an animation with that. It would just be unlike my typical brick films. It would be different trying to do something like that. It'd be more like a cartoon.
Yeah, ironically, like, it's actually a pretty adorable character, and also, but at that point, it's like, well, is that a build? Because none of the pieces are attached together. It's more like an arrangement, I guess.
It's like who was that Cheesy Bricks who did the Edward Cambridge, like, overhead shot? I mean, it was beautiful, but yeah, I mean, how much it qualifies as a Lego build if pieces aren't actually connected is a debate. That, you know, we could have for hours if we wanted to.
I mean, it's a Lego creation for sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
But the name of the chapter is not orienting for brick film, as it's building, so.
Ah, okay. And is clutch power, is that a copyrighted word by Lego, or is that just something that's come up along the way?
I don't believe so. I mean, it's the name that they give to the ability of the bricks and elements to stick together and stay there, but I don't think it's a trademark, despite the fact that the Lego group tries to trademark things that are not generally trademarkable, like the design of the brick. But yeah, I think you can say clutch power without fear of reprisal.
Yeah. Well, I'll have
clutch
to give
power
it to
him. On the other hand, the character is a Lego thing, and the less said about him, the better.
And, yeah, I guess Lego does have the best clutch power of all the bricks, so I got to give them credit for that.
Absolutely.
they're a lot easier, and they stick together a lot better. And I love your part where you went into the hinges and the turntables, so as, you know, showing people the opportunity what things you can create movement with. So I loved all the detail you went into there. I guess we can move on to chapter 5, working in different scales, which I guess both you guys have a lot of expertise in, going from micro to minifigure, all the way up to the Pagano puppets and the little guys scale. Do you have any insight into working in different scales?
Sure.
Yeah,
go ahead.
I was just going to say, working in different scales is one of the reasons I got into brick filming. It's a fun challenge, and it, you know, more so than, like, I love designing fun minifigures, but for me, there's nothing like building a character and, like, testing it out and figuring out where the joints will go and how I can get it to stand and all that kind of good stuff, because that's where the Lego building comes in, as far as I'm concerned, and especially when you have a limited palette of bricks or a limited supply, solving those creative design problems making a character that can move and stand on its own and then you can also animate it is a challenge I enjoy taking on.
Yeah, I think that some of my favorite brick films are the ones that go beyond the minifigure. So, you know, the classic example David and I use in every workshop we ever give is, you know, Robota, or Robota, not sure how to pronounce it, but, you know, it's this gorgeous 10-minute film, you know, featuring slightly larger than mini-land scale robots and fighting chickens, and it's, you know, it stands out among so many other brick films because it's Lego, but it doesn't necessarily just look like a minifigure, right? You know, so I've always loved that kind of stuff. I've dabbled in different things. Like, I did some Belleville scale characters I've used, done a little bit of micro scale work. I think that, you know, the fun part about Lego is that it's, you know, infinite possibility. So really, you know, I love minifigures, but also there's a wide world out there besides minifigures, and just want to emphasize that in the book.
Totally agree. Totally agree.
Yeah, absolutely. And Dave is also good at integrating strange, gigantic characters into the minifigure world of Nightly News at 9. Dave, what's the name of the monster that grows out of the soccer field? Soccersaurus. There you go. Of course. And just like that kind of stuff is really fun. Because not only do you have the brick built designs of a immense creature, but you also have it then interacting with the minifigure world.
And
go ahead. Yeah, I was just gonna say, basically any excuse I have to build a giant monster that can cause havoc, I'm gonna make that happen.
Likewise, I think that's another thing we have in common, because I've done stuff like. You know, we did the Garbage Man film that we entered into the Lego Movie Contest. Spoiler alert, there is a giant blob creature that will appear in the Magic Picnic that I built and was a pleasure okay. because he's big and goofy and fun. And even stuff like, you know, with... Oh, there's so much backstory to this. With the other forthcoming long-term project of mine, Little Guys in Space, there's a bunch of like neat alien creatures that will be appearing in that film. And while they aren't as necessarily as crazy or wild or Muppety as something like Garbage Man or the Magic Picnic Monster, they do have some fun brick-built stuff. And I don't know, it's just there's it takes me back to like. Looking at books that had all the great photography from Legoland parks, stuff like the, what is it, the Ultimate Lego book or whatever from the late 90s and even earlier ones, the Henry Wisenick History of Lego Toys or Guide to Lego Toys from the late 80s. There's all these like great like theme park model designs, and I've always... trying to recapture that notion from childhood of like, oh wow, like someone built that, someone took the time to put that together, and if I can inject that feeling and put it out to my audience and get the same idea across like that, I consider that a success.
Yeah, just building on that, pun intended.
I see what you did there.
You know, I think one thing that's you see a lot in just broader Lego fan community is, you know, really this emphasis on the build and not so much on the minifigure. And, you know, people are always talking about, like, NPU, like nice part usage, right? Like, where somebody uses a part in an unexpected way that causes you to, you know, think about it differently. And you can't really get that the same way at just building stuff at minifigure scale and focus on minifigures and brick film. So that's what I really love about, you know, escaping the minifigure scale is then it's much more of a sculptural experience in addition to just the filmmaking experience. And then, like, the things that I build that are beyond minifigure scale are the things that I'm most proud to show to other, like, adult fan builders as opposed to just adult fan animators. And it's, you know, one of the ways I'm able to, like, bridge that, like, huge gap that I feel like exists between the main LEGO fan community and the brick filming community.
Yeah, we're definitely the niche hobby within a niche hobby. And also, to talk to Dave's point about NPU, absolutely. Like, that's one of the most... there's a lot about the work that I do, and not to speak for Dave also, but I think he would probably have the same idea, believe it or not, that is mostly just about making myself laugh. Like, with, like, admittedly, it's not that hard, but a lot of what I do is just, like, finding strange or dumb, and I mean dumb affectionately, uses for offbeat parts. One of my favorite things that I've ever made is the characters from Country Buildin', the music video that we produced for the Lego Club show. And that one cowboy character, he's got his mustache is the flame pieces from Lego Castle. His belt buckle is the sun disc from the Adventurers Jungle Expedition sets. So finding ways to use stuff like that and incorporate it into brick films, like Dave was saying, is always just a pure delight.
And I think that's really important. I mean, you can just hear the excitement when you guys are talking about these, you know, builds and these cool characters that you're creating yourself, and you get excited making them, seeing them, and then to be able to animate with them, that really, like you said, it's a pure joy, and that really comes across in the end product, enjoying what you do and, you know, seeing, you know, what you can, you can create with them. It just makes it fun, and that is really what it's all about.
And, thanks, that means a lot.
And speaking of little guys in space, how's that coming along?
Well, as you might have been aware, we wrote a book.
Yeah, I kind of
just a little bit busy, right?
So let me give my, again, condolences to 2011 David Pagano, who during a brief stint of unemployment, maybe took on too many long-term projects that were slightly more, you know, my friend Umberto Cam often uses this phrase, which is like biting off more than you can chew and then sort of like begrudgingly sitting there and chewing all of it. And I feel like that's what I've done not only with this book, but also with Little Guys in Space, which fingers crossed will resume production in a month or two. That's all I will say, because I feel like every time in the past that I've given a release date for that film, it has just rolled on by with sadness in my heart. So I will just say that it's still going on. It by hook or by crook, I will finish and release that film.
Awesome. All right, your fans are very patient, so we'll be here waiting, and no worries on that.
And is
I want to see it too, everybody.
And is that also being done in 24 frames?
Yes, it is being done at 24 frames. The original Little Guys was actually 30, because I wanted to capture that that sort of 80s video kind of quality to it. I will almost undoubtedly never do a 30 frames per second film again, and I would like to give people listening the opportunity to bookmark this podcast so that when in the future I make that dumb decision again and make a 30 frames per second film, they can shove this in my face. But no, 24 seemed like keeping in the same little guy style, but not as insane or crazy.
Exactly. Well, you did compliment me a couple of times on one of my videos that I've done probably 3 seconds of 30 frame video. It was on the Grand Theft Auto, like the jet ski one.
Oh, there was water thing, right?
Yeah, and that one was
done at 30.
I figured I was only doing a second of video, so what was the difference between, you know, 15 or 30 pictures? You know, it was only going to take me 5 extra minutes. So I went ahead and did about 3 or 4 of the scenes in that in 30 frame, and I guess they came out good. But, yeah, it does take some time if you you bump up the frame rate.
Oh, yeah.
All right, let's move on to Chapter 6, the Tools of the Trade. I think we kind of went into a little of your early tools you used, this was a great chapter that discussed, you know, the cameras and your lighting and microphones and software. David Pickett, what are you using these days for, like, a camera and stop-motion capture software?
Bad decision back in, was that also 2011? I think 2011 is a key year that both of us would time travel back to tell ourselves certain things.
No regrets.
So I did a Kickstarter to buy a new camera for animation. And at the time, Micro Four Thirds cameras had just released. I don't know how much you know about Micro Four Thirds cameras, but there's a school of thought that Micro Four Thirds cameras are preferable to DSLRs for stop motion animation because they lack a physical shutter, so there's no moving part to wear out when you take hundreds of thousands of pictures. However, Micro Four Thirds cameras are like a weird just genre of camera that's not well integrated or recognized by most software programs, aka DragonFrame. So I have a Panasonic Lumix GH2, but I would switch it to any Canon camera in a heartbeat if I could go back in time and change that, because I have the most convoluted workaround to use animation software. I have a Wi-Fi enabled SD card in the camera, so my pictures actually sync over Wi-Fi to the software, and then it doesn't give me live view. So I had a was converting the video out of the camera to, you know, the red, white, and yellow cables, composite or component. I always get them confused.
That's composite.
And then reconverting that composite into USB to go into the camera, or to go into the computer. And then the live view was a totally different, like, size and aspect ratio than the actual pictures. So it was just, like, the opposite of what you hope for when you connect a camera to a computer, which is just like, oh, I like can control it from my computer and like everything looks the same and it's instantaneously updated. No, like I had no control over the camera from the computer. It took 30 seconds every time I took a picture for the computer to actually get it. So I'd have to like take a frame and just stand there waiting.
Wow.
For it to catch up. It's much better than what I was doing before, which was animating without any animation software ever. But, you know, one of the things I emphasize again in the book, in this chapter in particular, is to, like, make sure you know how your camera and your software work together, because that will make a huge difference in the amount of time and effort you're putting into this. So it's a long way of saying I wish I had read this book and been able to warn myself about getting that camera and made a different choice. But, you know, really in this chapter, one of the questions we get the most on YouTube in person is, like, what equipment we use. So we really wanted to put that to rest with this chapter and just have it forever be in a book. Like, oh, you want to know what camera I use? Buy our book.
Okay, fair enough.
I think I remember seeing a picture of your camera setup. And it was pretty Frankenstein looking to get to work around. So, but hey, at least you got it to work.
And to Dave's point, like we get asked the question a lot. Hey, what camera do you guys use? When really the question should be, what camera should I use? And that's why we sort of structured this chapter in a way that's like, here are all the options. Based on what your setup is, you can use these to make a decision. In terms of like what you have the budget for, what your computer and software requirements are, all that kind of stuff.
That is such a perfect point. You're right. They're asking that, and that is exactly what they want to know, is what they should use. That's such a great way of putting it, and such great information for them to have.
And what's nice is people these animators these days have so many options, ranging from the, you know, the smartphone, all the way up to the, you know, the webcam, to the DSLR cameras, and it's just, and this chapter really does go into all of those options.
Right, you don't have to have a lot of money in order to do stop motion, which is great.
No, in fact, we emphasize spending as little money as possible at multiple points in this book, just because that's not what it's about for us.
Well, I'd definitely say if you're going to spend some money, buy the book, folks. Buy the book. It's worth it.
That's the exception, yes.
got buy the book. Do you guys always use tripods, or do you use other type of mounting devices?
I generally tend to use the tripod. I have a pretty heavy Bogan tripod that I've used for, everything we've done in the last 6 years, and it has a the tripod head that is geared, so you can turn cranks and it will control, I guess it would be the roll, pitch, and yaw. In terms of how the camera sits relative to the animation surface that I put all my sets on. I've also done things where, and this is mostly with little guys in space stuff, where I'm trying to, you know, attach cameras to weird Lego things that I've kind of glued together so that I can put the camera into the set and things like that.
Yeah, I did all of the night news at 9 without a tripod. I was just doing table-based camera mounts for all of the shots. Most of my shots were just like head-on shots, so it was nice to be able to get down there close up and personal with minifigures most of the time, and I just had never seen the need for a tripod. So only I've been shooting all of my other Brick 101 videos on a tripod for the last couple of years, but even those started out as all table-based camera mounts. So, you know, I think it all depends on, you know, what you're trying to do and what kind of filmmaker you are, whether you want to get a tripod or just start off using, you know, the Lego you have around the house.
Absolutely. And I think another thing we try to get across in the book is, you know, there's a lot of different approaches to making a film, but there's not really like one correct answer. And it's really just up to the individual filmmaker to kind of feel out, you know, what works for me and what am I most comfortable working with and what is the solution to whatever creative problem that I'm taking on with the film I'm making that will work the best. So it's not about, yes, you should use a tripod or no, you shouldn't. It's more about, does a tripod make sense in this situation?
Okay.
Let your creative juices go to town.
Have you used any of the motorized... slider devices or anything like that?
Pagano?
I use very, let's say, kludged together alternatives to motorized slider devices. Lots of putting a tripod on a piece of cardboard that is next to a ruler that is taped to the floor, and then using, I'm going to throw out a kind of a trigger word here, using math to... to figure out how far to move the camera or the cardboard. I use a lot of like little spinning turntables, like kind of a kitchen turntable that you would keep your spices on in the cabinet. Anything that I can not spend a lot of money on. I don't have a lot of space in my studio, and I don't have a lot of money to spend on things like motion control rigs. But I try to make up for it by being creative with what I do have. And like with so many other things we've discussed, as long as it gets you to the visual goal that you're striving for, then that's all that really matters. I would love to be able to use some motion control stuff, but it has not been in the cards so far.
Okay.
Take it. How about you?
I am the opposite of a gearhead, so I have an Amazon Basics tripod, I have a camera that is a regrettable decision, and I have some desk lamps I bought at Target. That's my equipment package. That's it.
Well, it works, though.
What
so.
Kind of bulbs are you using these days, Pickett?
I use daylight balanced CFL light bulbs. I just think they bring out the color of Lego better than, the standard yellowish orange hued bulbs.
Okay. And Pagano, you have some more, more professional type lighting, studio type stuff. Is that correct?
Sort of. You know, we started out... when I went to film school, it was sort of on the tail end of a lot of things. You know, it was right around the time that the broadcast video standard here in the U.S. changed. So I have a ton of mental information about the old broadcast standard that is completely useless now. But in that era, I was starting to do things with, you know, really... old kind of clunky lights from companies like Arri and Lowell, just really like the warmest warm light you could possibly imagine. And I mean that in the temperature sense, not the color temperature sense. When I made the film Little Guys, I actually melted part of the ceiling in my parents' basement.
Oh my gosh.
So that was not great. But in the interest of not losing 20 pounds of sweat every time I make a film, as we've gone on with newer productions, we've started to move away from those sorts of more traditional motion picture lights and move towards things like LED panels and soft boxes that have either CFLs or LED bulbs in them, just because as new lighting technology comes out, not only is it cooler to the touch, it's also more long lasting. So that's stuff that we've been experimenting with now. So we've actually started to phase out a lot of the old, more quote unquote professional lights.
Yeah. They're more expensive to
but
run,
as as Dave Pickett was saying, you can use lamps from a department store. It's all about what you do with them.
Yeah, which we do.
Yeah, I'm actually really happy with. I've got these little little silver, or I guess aluminum work lights that we just recently switched over to LED. So I think I'm only running 15 watts a light, compared to I think I was at 75 and 100 before that. So.
Oh yeah, no. Oh, in my old studio we had like
500 and 1,000, if not 2,000.
Yeah, which was not great. Especially because the sun would also hit the side of our building at about 4:30 p.m. every day. So in addition to sweating buckets from standing next to the lights, we would also have the temperature in the room just rise exponentially as we would get into the later part of the workday. You can actually see in our book, there's a photo from my old studio of the window blocking sun covers that we had to prevent the majority of the sunlight heat from coming in. But I don't miss those days.
Yeah, I bet not.
One of my favorite pages in the books was the one entitled Odds and Ends. It's because it's kind of a question I've been asking on a lot of these podcasts, if people have a little tray or a little small box full of, I guess, odds and ends type things. In there, and with the brush or different little tools for tweaking your Lego as you animate. Whose box is this a picture of, or is this one just made for the book?
This is actually the shooting tray that we use at work, and I have to give complete credit to my production manager Valerie Champagne for one day just being like, "Why don't you put all the stuff that you constantly use into a tray?" And I was like, yeah, that's a really good idea. This is why we work together. So that's I have that on a little shelf next to me while I animate, and it has been invaluable.
It looks a little
bit
like
I have a lot of the same things, but just in one of those small pick-a-brick containers. So I just kind of like dump that out. So I should probably upgrade to a tray as well, but... I think we have a lot of the same little tools. Listening to this podcast, toothpicks have stuck out to me as something that like people don't think of until they're, maybe on their third or fourth animation. So that's one thing I always like to emphasize is the magic of the toothpick.
Or in my case, like the, 48th animation. that was one of the greatest gifts Dave Pickett ever gave me, was saying, how often and how invaluable the toothpick was as a mode of minifigure movement.
That's an awesome tip.
Definitely an awesome tip there. I dig the little Lego measuring devices. Those are really cool.
Thanks. Yeah, those are... I actually use a lot of the... I think in 2009, Lego put out a Lego ruler as just like one of their little gear products in the same vein as the brick separator. And they put it out in 2009 and stopped producing it in 2000, possibly 9 or 10. I don't know why they stopped, but I really love them. But in terms of things that are available for people who are buying the book, we wanted to give an option that was... more attainable, and using products that are no longer available didn't really fit in with what we wanted to accomplish with the book. So I put together those little things that are actually tinier versions of the kinds of rulers that Sean Kenny and his team use for their large scale sculptures. But they have ones that are maybe 30 bricks tall and 48 studs wide, as opposed to these tinier ones, which are a little more suited for the minifigure brick filming scale.
Cool. You guys both use Dragon Frame, is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay. I think I remember a tweet or something a few years ago that Pagano, you said that basically it just really helped your flow of your workflow using that software. And I was about a year or two after you getting the software, and definitely it helped the workflow for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we've gone through several different software packages, just sort of feeling out what we needed for the productions we were involved in at the time. I think when we started doing stuff for the Lego group a few years ago, it was 2009. Oh man, I'm old. we started with Stop Motion Pro, which I don't have a lot of fond memories of, but I also don't have a lot of negative memories of. It just sort of, it worked. It took pictures at the time. You know, as we've progressed and gone through more and more productions, and certainly as we've been able to afford different things, I don't know that Dragon would have been something we could have afforded at the time, because I think even Stop Motion Pro I bought with a student discount. You know, Dragon Frame, it's used on so many productions, it's well loved, it has lots of features and that nifty numpad accessory, which I wish was Bluetooth enabled sometimes. It's just been invaluable to have as part of our toolbox.
Student discount is a good point too, because there are a lot of great discounts for students, whether it's computers and software that are, you know, that are allowed that way. So that's a helpful.
Oh yeah, take advantage of all that stuff,
definitely.
Listeners.
Cool. Well, let's move on to chapter 7, is the creative process, brainstorming, script writing, storyboarding. You guys take a little bit different approach, or is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things we love doing throughout this book is finding any minute difference in our process, and sort of trying to point that out as, you know, there's many different ways to make a brick film, and that's why we have our little author sig figs throughout the book to, like, highlight our differences of opinion. But yeah, I mean, in this chapter, it really comes out the differences we have in terms of doing the play approach versus the plan approach. David is much more of a planner than I am. I definitely improvise a lot more of my stuff, even after I've scripted. You know, I don't typically do storyboards, so I'm improvising on set how this shot is going to look and things like that. So yeah, again, it's... I think, both value the planning process, but also understand sometimes you need to be a little more flexible, and especially when somebody's starting, you know, you're not necessarily going to do all the steps of, like, brainstorming, writing a script, doing the table read, you know, recording voices ahead of time, so that there's definitely some flexibility there.
And Pagano, do you do storyboarding and animatics?
It all depends on the production, to be honest. With stuff like the work we do for the Lego group or for ad agencies or whoever, you know, a lot of times there'll be storyboards that we receive from them that are like, hey, this is kind of what we're thinking of. Like, does this work on budget, or is this something that's achievable through stop motion? So in that sense, we get storyboards. I'm admittedly terrible at drawing myself, I probably should have put the comma in a different place in that sentence. I'm terrible at drawing myself. I can draw myself okay, so what I tend to do is, instead of doing storyboards, I do what I call a photo animatic, I'm sure I'm not the originator of this idea, but essentially what I'm doing is taking still images to figure out what each shot will look like, and it could either be with the camera I'm shooting with or with my phone, but just to get a sense of where the camera will be, like a rough idea of shot composition, and you know, figuring out where the bounds of the set need to be so that I'm not building more than I need to, and that's really useful also in terms of if we have a tight deadline. You know, using a photo animatic gets the set design and the storyboarding process kind of in front of a client's face all at once, so that it's not dragging out the process for longer than it needs to be. But then also to what Dave was just talking about, like, I'm definitely more of a planner now. And it was actually, you know, one of the many reasons why it was a pleasure to write this book with Dave Pickett was because I'm sort of set in my ways in a lot of areas. And he was instrumental in sort of being like, well, that's what you do. But like, also we need to make sure that we're giving readers, not only readers who are starting out, but readers who may want to go in any other different direction, all of the options. So it's not just about, I feel like if I wrote this book myself, it would have been a lot more about what my process is. But what we tried to achieve together was to talk about what all of the options, again, for any kind of process can be. And to be honest, like, as planny as I am, I started out with the play approach in the exact same way where, you know, longtime Brick Film watchers will remember a film that I made way back in 2001 called Haunted. And that was definitely made with the play approach where I just sort of built this haunted house and then was like, oh, okay, I've got this haunted house. Who can go there? What kinds of characters are hanging out? Why are they hanging out there? What happens when they're there? Who lives in the haunted house? All those kinds of questions that we kind of guide readers through in this chapter to help them flesh out their own film ideas.
That's great.
Definitely. That's one of the real magic things about this book is it has this double approach towards different subjects, and you don't just get one author's opinion or approach to it, and it really adds an extra dimension to the book. And that's,
so it will apply to everyone.
And the Sig Figs are just adorable, and their insight and little comments that they make throughout their book are just wonderful. I mean, it's your
thank
comment.
You.
moving into chapter 8, cinematography and production, kind of go into the aspect ratio, frame rate, and all that kind of typical stuff there. Light theory was really interesting, and you also talked about light flicker. Any insight y'all have into that chapter?
Pickett?
Yeah. I think that, you know, what's interesting about the way we structured the book overall is that the actual filmmaking process we save till the end here. We really dive in the front into just like some down and dirty stuff, like how to make your first animation, then focusing on all the Lego specific stuff. And then the latter half of the book, then we actually go through like, okay, well, here's pre-production, production, and post-production. And we kind of arrived on that structure because we wanted to focus specifically on what people need to know first. And then like kind of, as they go through the book, they can, you know, make animations throughout and kind of grow. So that's kind of how we got to having something that seems really key to filmmaking, like how to focus your camera, like almost at the end of the book. But yeah, I mean, I think, again, there's just like lots of great principles demonstrated here. My favorite thing in this chapter is probably the headroom joke that David put in.
Yeah, my Max Headroom fandom is shameless, and even if you watch Little Guys, there's lots of little in jokes to the TV show Max Headroom, which is a favorite of mine.
I remember that show; it was a long time ago.
Yep.
I liked your portion on light flicker. I kind of experienced a little bit of it this summer, and I guess I'm thinking it was because the air conditioning and everybody in the neighborhood or whatnot running their air conditioning. I had a lot better success in the morning, but when the sun came up, it seemed like a lot of appliances around the house and the neighborhood were kicking on, and I was getting a little light flicker here and there.
Oh yeah, it happens to the best of us, Dave. we had a situation at work where, so my studio in the back of the building is on a different electrical circuit. So, you know, when we do use the sort of heavier filmmaking lights, it doesn't affect the rest of the building. But what was affecting us one day was we were trying to figure out why we had inconsistent light, and we realized that it was because even though our room, all the outlets are on a different circuit, the overhead light in the room, just like the lights that are built into the ceiling, were connected to the lighting grid from the rest of the building. And when a person, so our studio is back to back with a wood shop, And when a person was using the table saw and the table saw would turn on and off, it would mildly dim the overhead lights in the room for like a split second. And so we had to very politely ask them to not use the table saw while we were in the middle of shooting, just so that we could keep our lighting consistent.
Wow. At least you figured it out.
Yeah, but and that's one of the things we talk about in the chapter, which is just like people ask us, like, why is this happening? And the answer can be, you know, a thousandfold different little things that all contribute. It took me a long time to realize that I should not wear like brightly colored shirts to work. I should try to wear either monochromatic colors or that's a contradiction. Monochromatic clothing, black or white clothing, depending on what I'm standing against. And also not standing too close to the set, standing kind of in the same place every time I take a picture, because Lego bricks and elements and characters are super reflective and they're going to reflect everything even when you don't want them to. So trying to suss out as many of those factors as possible is the advice that we try to guide people through in that section.
Yeah, I was once filming a shot where no matter like where I was, like I was ending up like in the reflection of some brick. I don't know, it was something shiny and like straight on. So I ended up like every time I would take a picture, I would hide under my desk and use my camera remote to take the picture. So I mean the source of light flicker, it can be incredibly difficult to track down, which is why it's really important. Going back to one of the principles we kind of talk about in chapter 3 is like trial and error. Like it's so important when you like come across something to like really kind of isolate all of the possible factors. So doing different lighting tests with different lamps or, you know, with different software controlling your camera. Sometimes like webcams have secret settings that most software can't control. I was using a webcam for part of the nightly news at 9 and it had a automatic color correct feature that I didn't realize. So I was actually getting like some color based light flicker. But that was like because of the webcam software. So there's so many different possible contributing factors. You really have to just like try everything.
Tap into your inner Sherlock Holmes and do a lot of test animations.
Absolutely. And also talking about hiding under a desk, you know, yet another thing that we wanted to get across with this book was that even though Dave and I do this for a living, like we are not immune to these things. And, you know, it kind of harkens back to when I was a kid and I would look at like behind the scenes of The Empire Strikes Back and they're shooting the Snowwalkers and they're just coming up through a little trap door in the table. Like you always have to find these kind of creative solutions to getting the shots that you want and keeping all of the other factors that are going to affect your work at bay.
Great advice.
Cool. Getting close to the end here. We got chapter 9, which is post-production, goes into sound, editing, compositing, and then sharing online. You guys have any quick insight of that?
Yeah, this for me was, so David's chapter that broke him was chapter 3. Chapter 9 was almost the chapter that broke me, just because it's like the least Lego-y chapter of the whole book, because editing, sound, like neither of those things requires Lego in any way, shape, or form. So even trying to like think about how do we visualize this and how do we make it feel similar to the rest of the chapters, which are so picture-heavy, even though this is an incredibly text-heavy chapter. And the other thing is that there are so many different possible editing setups that it's really hard to talk broadly about those without being specifically like, here's how you use Final Cut or here's how you use Adobe Premiere or Avid or whatever software people are using. So trying to keep it broad while also giving enough information that people can follow along, It was a really hard balance to strike, but you know I think we ended up getting some really good information in there that I think especially you know new animators and filmmakers will find really useful.
We also had the there was a period when we were in the thick of writing this book where I think maybe knowingly or unknowingly we just sort of pushed a lot of stuff content-wise, and we were just saying to ourselves, yeah, we'll cover that in chapter 9. Like, don't worry about it. And then when it came time to write chapter 9, we were just like, oh, there's all this stuff that we have to put in here now. How do we make this all fit together? And I think Dave did a really good job of kind of wrangling all that stuff, especially this stuff about sound, because sound is such like a critical part of any film. You know, it's not necessary to animation necessarily, just in the way that like you can do stop motion and it can be silent.
Well, it's unlike live action. When you shoot live action, sound is always happening. But when you shoot animation, right, you're literally only capturing video. So sound is a whole separate process. But, you know, as you were saying, it's so important to the final work, but you have to, it's all separate. Yeah.
Thank you, Dave, for having words.
One of the things we said a lot as we were writing this book is that we are two people who together have at least one functional brain. So we were finishing each other's sentences quite often throughout the book, very literally.
Cool. What are you guys using as for a recording device, just if you don't mind me asking, for audio?
Oh, go ahead, Dave. It begins. So I'm currently, as we speak, recording with a, what is this? It's a Behringer microphone.
Okay.
And it was like a 3-pack of microphones that I got on Amazon for like $30-something.
Wow.
I have it plugged into a little mixer, which I'm noticing is also Behringer. And I don't think I realized that. Because I bought them both separately. And then that's just plugged into my computer here. But when I'm recording sound, I'm either using that or I have a little field recorder that I use sometimes for location sound. It's a, I believe, a H2 handy recorder that's about almost 10 years old at this point. And that has like a little microphone built in, and it records to an SD card.
That's what we have. That's what we're using right now.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. David Pickett.
I recently purchased a Blue Yeti microphone. I don't think I've used it in any of my, animations or even Lego videos. For Brick 101 videos, I've been using my onboard camera microphone. I also recently got a wired lav, which is an Audio-Technica. But most of my Brick Film recording was done on just like a cheapo USB microphone that doesn't even have like a brand name, or maybe it does. It's a Logitech, that I've had for over a decade that, you know, it just worked. And so I never saw a need to like spend much more money on microphones until really recently.
Okay. What are y'all editing on? Start with Pickett.
Yeah, I'm using Final Cut. For a long time, I was on Legacy Final Cut 7, which, you know, Apple abandoned like 7 years ago, but like I still had installed on my computer and it was like what I had learned on, so I just kind of stuck with it. But I recently, about a year ago, made the switch over to Final Cut X, and that's been great. I'm not doing a lot of super complicated editing for most of my videos right now, so it's been really functional.
And the stuff we do at work is, a lot of it is short form, and the way that our workflow kind of happens in terms of the shooting and the editing and compositing and all that kind of good stuff, we basically just do our editing in After Effects, which is part of the Adobe Creative Cloud. When we have to actually shoot and edit like longer form stuff or like behind the scenes stuff, we just do that in Premiere. I kind of grew up on a lot of the Adobe stuff. I've been using After Effects since high school. So all that stuff is near and dear to my heart, even though I'm not thrilled about having to subscribe to software as opposed to just buying it and owning it outright.
Yeah, that's kind of my dilemma. Part of me wants to go with Final Cut, 10, but I've just really gotten hooked on After Effects and with the cloud also having Photoshop, and it would be hard to give those two up. I could give up Premiere, I think, but not the other two.
Yeah, I got you. And, you know, honestly, it's largely why we moved to the Creative Cloud model is just because a lot of times with our commissioned work, we're pulling in a lot of freelance people to help us with effects and post-production. And having everybody on the same up-to-date software is key. So for our workflow, that was the answer. But if you're just doing your own thing in your own studio, it's not going to be the same answer for you necessarily.
Yeah, you have to find what fits you the best and your budget.
You got it.
Mm-hmm. Kind of close to, I guess, the end of the book, there are some the final thoughts there. Do you guys have anything to round up, anything we might have missed covering?
I think we should devote an entire hour to talking about the wonderful index in this book.
Oh, yeah.
I think we really touched on all the different topics in the book, at least in passing. And, I think we just really wanted it to be the book that is, you know, the perfect way for somebody who's just getting into animation, but also as you're growing as an animator, we hope that this will, you know, kind of grow with people, that they'll be able to, you know, go from the basics and then, like, using the equipment recommendations to buy their, you know, first or second camera and kind of moving up from there, and that they'll find more depth going back into some of the chapters as they grow as an animator.
Yeah, it was definitely really important to us that, you know, Lego is a children's toy, and we all acknowledge that, but it was important to us that this book was for anybody. And that's not necessarily to say that it's for everybody, because not everybody necessarily wants to be a filmmaker. But we hope that we've been successful in sort of making it inclusive. You know, I'm a big proponent of the idea that art is for everybody, regardless of what kind of art you choose to pursue. And so we really wanted to make this book just sort of not talk down to people, but just sort of have it be an inclusive way to bring others into the fold with the insane world of brick filming. I think there's a lot of pop culture, and there's a lot of geek culture that tries to be exclusive, I think, in a lot of ways, where it's like, oh, you don't necessarily like this. I get people telling me, like, oh, you don't like this thing the correct way. And I'm like, well, what's the correct way? That doesn't make any sense. So we tried to make this book as accessible as possible, as welcoming as possible, because if there are more people joining us in the world of brick filming, I think that's only a good thing. And anything we can do to help shepherd those people into our little nook of the Lego fan community, sort of trailed off there at the end, but I get emotional about being inclusive when it comes to art.
No, I couldn't agree more. And that's the great thing about your book, is that whether you are just starting animating, whether you're considering it, parents for their kids, boys and girls, or whether you've been animating for years, there is something for everybody that you can learn from this book in such a wonderful and easy laid out way. It's really incredible the way you guys wrote it. It's just brilliant. So kudos. And congratulations, because I've had so many people, I think, you know, my kid would enjoy this. Well, yeah, absolutely. And then I give them the link, and it's so much fun. It's like, you definitely want to get this book, because this will help them do, you know, what they want to do. Anytime you can get a kid doing creative things, and grown-ups as well. I mean, it's just a wonderful outlet. It's a wonderful community to be a part of, getting more popular all the time. And really couldn't be happier to share this book with everyone.
Thank you. We appreciate it. You know, you talked about parents specifically, and I know you guys are parents. You know, we really kind of, Dave and I are both fans of the Jim Henson model of, you know, having things that are not only for children, but are for also for the adults that are watching things with children, or in this case, reading things. And not only that, but having something that you can enjoy as a child, and even if you go away for a while, if you come back to it, there's still value there. So again, just really a book with something for everyone was our goal.
Well, you definitely succeeded there.
Excellent. I'm glad to hear it.
And what discussing this book has done for us is we've pretty much gone through about the length of a podcast that we typically like to do without going into our typical podcast questions. So perhaps one day we'll be able to go into those questions with you guys separately, perhaps just to kind of get into a little more detail about you personally. But definitely, the book definitely made a great thing to talk about for this podcast. So I appreciate you guys taking the time to talk with us.
Yeah, thanks for having us again. This was fun to talk about it in such depth with, you know, people who know something about animation.
Could not agree more. We will be more than happy to join you guys again for anything you would like to discuss with us. This has been fun.
Well, you guys are definitely stars in our little industry, so we look forward to talking to you again in the future.
And looking forward to the Magic Picnic, and we'll make sure everyone has all the links to get your book, and we'll be happy to promote all this because everybody definitely needs to read this book. It's a pure joy.
Thank you.
So thank you both again for joining us. Good luck with the book and the Magic Picnic and everything else. Your work is amazing, both of you. So we look forward to everything you do.
Cool. And moving forward, everybody can always find stuff about the book at setbump.com/book. That will be the continuing source for everything that we do related to this book.
We'll make sure everybody has the links to that as well.
Excellent. Great. Thanks, guys.
So have a great weekend. Thanks again for joining us.
You too.
Yeah, thank you.
And we'll talk to you soon.
Cool. Thanks, guys.
All
right. Bye.
Thanks to David and David for being so generous with their time, and thanks to everyone who stuck with us through this entire podcast. Please check out our sponsors and partners on the Brickfilmers Guild homepage, and don't forget to check out both David Pickett's and David Pagano's amazing brick films on their YouTube channels. And don't forget to buy their book. It would be perfect for the holidays or any other time. It's really just a great gift for anyone and such a fun read. If you would like to sponsor one of our podcasts, please contact me through one of our social media sites. We'd also like to thank Kevin MacLeod for his wonderful music, which we use for our podcasts and in our brick films. Also, if you are listening to this podcast on iTunes, please rate and comment. We'd really appreciate that. So until next time, bye y'all.